great to come to church. It's good to say hello to everybody. It's good to say hello to God. It's good to listen to God. We still have COVID restrictions, unfortunately. Technically, we're allowed to sing if we all wear masks and go further apart from each other, so we're not doing that. But we're going to watch some singing a bit later. Church has got a few interesting things tonight. The most special thing that's happening, actually, is we're having a baptism of Katrina. You'll hear about that very, very soon. I love baptisms. They're great. We're going to all go down to the beach in a while. So we'll hear a short talk by Blake. We're continuing our series in the fruit of the Spirit. We've done love, joy, peace, and today we're doing patience, which is a very important topic. And then after that, as I said, Katrina is going to be baptized down the beach. Fantastic public demonstration of an internal spiritual reality that's happened. We'll all be encouraged by that. In a few seconds, the kids are going to go up to church. I have a shortened kids' church because we're going to have a shortened period here because we're walking down to the beach. And they're going to go up with Daz and Avery. So thanks for helping with those kids, you guys. Really good. Just a few things. Apart from the COVID stuff, if you haven't signed in, scanned in, please do, because we can get booked if you don't sign in. And if you're not in a household with someone that you're less than 1.5 next to, you probably have to move a bit further away. The other thing is sanitize. Please sanitize your hands. Christianity Explored is a great course. We run it quite regularly here, and Blake's about to start another one of that tomorrow night, Mondays, 7:30 at his place. It's not too late to book in. It's getting close to being a little bit full, but it's not too late if you want to come to the Christianity Explored. I think it's 8 weeks, 6 weeks. He's not looking at me. 6 to 8 weeks of discussion about the claim of Christianity. Really good course. Every time I've run it or watched other people do Christianity Explored, they actually love it. So Christianity Explored starting tomorrow. Let me pray as we get together. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for speaking to us so clearly in your word. We thank you for this church. Thanks for the privilege of coming here this afternoon. We look forward to listening from your word. We also look forward to watching Katrina get baptized. And I pray that that process will be a really healthy and encouraging time for her, but also for us. Lord, help us to leave all our ponderings and anxieties and distractions away as we open our ears and our hearts to focus on you and listen to you. And I pray that your spirit would move amongst us tonight. Help us to see Jesus. Help us to hear what he's saying to us. And help us to know how to apply it in our lives. Give us the courage to do that. And Lord, I pray that we all leave equipped to be your people in our own situation. In Jesus' name, amen. So the kids, you can go now to kids' church. Thanks, Daz. Thanks, Avery. They're taking them up. Good class. Hope it goes well. We'll send someone up to pull you down when it's ready. It's not going to be long. It's going to be a short time. We've got the Bible reading now. So you get your Bibles here. It's Galatians chapter 5 is our first Bible reading. Galatians chapter 5. We've read this a few times over the last few weeks. And if you've been here the last few weeks, you'll notice this one. It's a passage where it goes through the fruit of the Spirit. I'm going to read that now. Galatians chapter 5 from verse 16. So I say, live by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the sinful nature. For the sinful nature desires what is contrary to the Spirit, and the Spirit what is contrary to the sinful nature. They are in conflict with each other, so that you do not do what you want. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under law. The acts of the sinful nature are obvious. Sexual immorality, impurity, debauchery, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambition, dissensions, factions, and envy, drunkenness, orgies, and the like. I warn you, as I did before, that those who live like this will not inherit the kingdom of God. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things there is no law. Those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the sinful nature with its passions and desires. Since we live by the Spirit, let us keep in step with the Spirit. Let us not become conceited, provoking and envying each other. So that passage is what we've looked at over the last few weeks, where we've explored each one of those, and we're up to patience this evening. I'm looking forward to that one. And the next Bible reading, we're just going to reflect again on patience. It's from James. James, it's a bit later in the New Testament. James chapter 5 again, and from verse 7. James 5 from verse 7. Be patient then, brothers, until the Lord's coming. See how the farmer waits for the land to yield its valuable crop, and how patient he is for the autumn and spring rains. You too, be patient and stand firm, because the Lord's coming is near. Don't grumble against each other, brothers, or you'll be judged. The judge is standing at the door. Brothers, as an example of patience in the face of suffering, take the prophets who spoke in the name of the Lord. So that's the two passages that Blake's going to reflect on in a while. But he's doing that right now. So thanks, Blake. Let me just pray as it comes up. Dear Lord, I pray that you would speak to us now as Blake opens your word and help us to listen. In Jesus' name.
Thank you. Well, what a delightful thing to be doing this afternoon. I don't normally wear thongs when preaching. I don't think it's illegal, but I normally don't. But today, there's good reason to, so there you go. Sunscreen and thongs on. I have a fair bit of tension with someone in my life who's close to me and has been building for a number of years and just reached a head in the last year or so, and we stopped talking to each other. And that person finally, in answer to some of my prayers, rang me, and I saw the phone call come up on the car screen, kids were in the back, and I thought, this is a good start, maybe this is a time for reconnection. And I answered it, and I can tell you within 30 seconds, it was starting to go downhill, and within 1 minute, the person hung up on me after just having a go at me, really, and saying some stuff in front of the kids that was inappropriate. And I said, hey, hang on, the kids are here. I really want to talk to you, but the kids are here, so just maybe I can call you back. And they just kept going, and then they hung up. It was horrible. And I was so hurt, and I did what I do. I wonder what you do in those moments, but I did what I do, which is I wrote a text. I wonder what your sword is. Mine is write an SMS, and I describe what they've done wrong, and I told them in the future it's going to be like this, and I'm not going to be around you, so you won't be able to do that kind of thing, and this is why it was so painful. And I wrote my text, and I needed to send that. I had to protect myself and to just kind of get it off my chest and just for some low-level justice. And so I did about the wisest thing, and I asked Sarah, can you just check this before I send it? It wasn't, should I send it? It was, can you just check this? Maybe a word or two needs changing. And my beautiful wise wife said, why don't you just wait? And I knew inside myself, I could not wait. I didn't ask her to tell me to wait. I asked her if there was a word or two. That's what I was really looking for. She said, why don't you just wait over the weekend? And if you need to send it on Monday, send it on Monday. Maybe show it to a friend, a Christian friend you trust. But why don't you just wait? And I said in answer, the only thing I could say, which was, I'll pray about it. And what I meant, because it's all I could mean, was I'm sending it after I pray about it. Because I needed to. I was so angry and so hurt. And I prayed. And in the middle of my prayer, God opened up a possibility of waiting that wasn't there before that. Suddenly I could see, there's a little opening that means I could wait. And it felt horrible, but I was able to wait. And I can tell you, but I'm not going to tell you in length, the things that happened because I waited and the things that other people did and the things that God did in the following week are amazing and miraculous and beautiful. What happened in the week after that? Because I was able to wait. We're talking about patience today. Galatians chapter 5, before it talks about patience, says that there's a force inside every single person, just a thing that drives, that leads you, called the flesh. There's a thing inside you called the flesh that leads. And if you don't swim against the flesh's current, you'll tend to just live according to your desires and your hungers and your cravings, a bit like an animal, actually. That's what the flesh, if you keep in step with it, will lead you to. But for the Christian, there's a second thing. The flesh is there. The flesh is there. But there's a second thing for the Christian called the Spirit. Really, it's God's Spirit. God's Spirit is a second driving force in the Christian person. And if you'll keep in step with it, and if you'll just watch where the leading of his Spirit. If you'll keep in step, see where he's stepping and follow after him, he'll lead you not to just your cravings and desires, but he'll lead and bring about beautiful things in your heart and and bring about life, but not just inside of you, but around you as well. If you'll let the Spirit do his work. And Galatians goes on and says, one of the things that he wants to lead you to, one of the things that you ought to keep in step with and it'll happen is patience. God wants to grow patience in us. It's called the fruit of the Spirit, because if the Spirit gets to lead, he'll bring patience about in your heart and in your life. Patience is about time. It's about being able to go slow. It's about being able to go, but go slow. It's about not reacting just to the immediate. I'm going to act in my situation as though this immediate moment is the only moment that matters. That's not patience. But patience is this immediate moment, and what I want right now is not the only truth. There's a longer game. Patience is about seeing a longer game. It's very clear in chess. Chess is not about start and the first person who can take the other person's piece, the first piece off the board, that person loses. That's not how chess works, is it? It's a slow game, and it's not about the first piece or even the second piece, even if I play like that sometimes. I got the first two pieces. Who cares if you got the first two pieces? It doesn't matter, because the game is a long game. And it's about what happens an hour down the road, 2 hours down the road. And patience is not about the first piece or the second piece. In the immediate, it's not about sending the text right there in that moment. It's about the long game. Actually, one of the old English words that's actually based on the root Greek for patience here in Galatians chapter 5 is long suffering. Long suffering is one of the kind of real basic meanings of patience. It means that you suffer long. You keep on suffering. And that's what happened on the couch when I had my text written. I was suffering and I wanted to immediately fix it. And would it have fixed it? A little bit, actually. It would have eased things in some way. But instead, with my wife's beautiful invitation, I suffered longer. I suffered longer. Long suffering, that's patience. And then God did something good with that, with long suffering. And I'll just say right here, so we don't get mixed up, it's not that Christians like suffering. It's for another reason, which we'll see soon. But sometimes we need to suffer long. And so I want you to think about the areas of your life where God might be leading you by his Spirit, which he puts inside the people who follow him, where he might be leading you to suffer longer than you would if it was just about the immediate moment. Maybe there's an acute conflict with someone in your life, or maybe actually there's just kind of ongoing frustration with someone. There's no blow up of conflict on the phone like I had, but it's just ongoing difficulty and it calls for you to suffer longer. Or maybe it's a sickness that has been around for 3 weeks. I've been sick since December with just kind of some background stuff that slows me down. I feel more tired. It's been 2 months, really frustrating. But maybe for you it's been 2 years, or maybe it's been 20 years, or maybe you know after 2 years or 20 years, actually this is one that's sticking around, I'm stuck with this for now. And it calls for a kind of patience. Or maybe there's you're frustrated with your life station at the moment. You wanted to be married by this point, but you're not. or you are married and you kind of wish that you weren't, or you wish that you could have kids at this point, but you don't. Or you've worked hard and studied, but you don't have the job that really you, and we can even use the word deserve, maybe you deserve a certain kind of job, but it just hasn't come up for you, and you're frustrated. There's a kind of suffering, and it calls for, well, at least God is, I imagine, calling in your life. No, I know, God calls his Christian people. He wants to grow in them patience and long-suffering. And there's two, it comes to my mind, at least two alternatives to patience in that moment of conflict, in that moment of long frustration with a person, in that moment of sickness, in that season of a life station that's frustrating. There's some alternatives to patience. Sometimes we want to smash the suffering and just fix it up. We want to get rid of it. Or sometimes we're smashed by our suffering and we're just owned by it. And we don't feel like there's anything we could do. We couldn't smash it if we wanted to, and we just give up in that thing. But God calls us to a different kind of thing, not to smash our suffering and not to be smashed by our suffering, but to suffer long, to be patient in it. I'm trying to keep it short because I want to get us down to the beach before long, so I'm going to shorten this illustration. Abraham in the Old Testament is given in Hebrews chapter 6 as an example of patience over his lifetime. But there is also a point in his lifetime where he's very impatient and serves as an example of impatience. In Genesis chapter 12, God promises, and God has promised us certain things. I want you to notice the similarities between the structure of your faith and the structure of Abraham's faith. Notice this here. God has promised Abraham certain things. He says to Abraham in Genesis chapter 12, I am going to make you into a great nation. I know that you're sibling. God doesn't say this, but the situation is Abraham and Sarah, who he's married to, Abraham's 75, Sarah's a similar age. That's getting on, right? That's at least it's, you know, that's the middle of the life, not middle of life, if not a little further, 75. But she's barren and hasn't been able to have kids. And you don't get more likely to have kids as you hit 75, do you? But God says, I promise you, you will have children, and not just children. I'm going to turn you into a great nation. How unbelievable would that be to hear that from God as a 75-year-old married to a barren woman? I'm going to turn you into a great nation. And you won't just be big in numbers. I'm going to bless you. And through you, through the nation that's going to come, Israel, the Jews, I will bring blessing to all the nations on the earth. That's the promise to Abraham. And Abraham trusts God. And he sets out and does what God says. And so he's looking for the promise of God. And I wonder if you've heard the promise of God in your life. I hope you haven't heard a different version of the promise of God. God wants to give you the best career you could imagine. God's going to set you up with a beautiful husband and 6 kids. God doesn't promise that. But God does have very powerful and profound promises for your life that you need to notice what they actually are. You need to notice what the promises of God aren't, because they might come or they might not. But you need to notice more particularly, what are the promises that God has promised you through Jesus? And Abraham is looking for the promise. And what is it for him? It's a little different to us. Abraham's looking for children. And he gets from 75, 10 years later, he's 85 and there's no children. And so he does that alternative to patience. He smashes his suffering. What Abraham and Sarah decide to do is they say, well, God's promised this. We should expect it. They take things into their own hands and said, well, Hagar, she's a young lady. Why don't you take her into your bedroom and you can sleep with her and she'll get pregnant and then we'll have the promise of God. They smash their suffering. Instead of being patient, they take things in their own hands, and it's terrible what happens, what follows. Poor Hagar has a child, Ishmael, and a nation comes out of Ishmael. But it's not good what happens. And pretty soon, as you can imagine, when there's kind of a married couple, but then there's a third part, there's Hagar has slept with Abraham. Of course, there's going to be tensions, aren't there? There's tensions. And soon enough, Hagar is sent away into the desert. It's terrible. This single woman who's been used gets sent into the desert away from Abraham's family. It's really terrible. And impatience, if you go outside of God's bounds of the ways that he's leading us and the way that the chessboard sits, and you start to kind of smash instead of wait, then ugly things happen, selfish things happen, and people get hurt. it's an example of smashing our suffering instead of suffering it long. Because the thing is, he ends up as an example of patience because he does wait another 10 years on top of 85, so 20 years, 20 or so years. And then God answers his promise and does what looked impossible for 20 years. And I just briefly want to say, I wonder if you've heard the promise of God, what God has to offer you in Jesus, abundant life. And I wonder if it looks impossible at this point. And I want you to see that later Sarah will laugh and call her child, he laughs. Isaac means he laughs. Because it was laughable and beautiful. And God answers his promise and God will work out what he's working out, what he's promised to do. Okay, God's calling us to patience. And I've said there's some alternatives. We can either smash our suffering or be smashed by it and kind of give up. But there's a third thing, which is patience. And patience is different from giving up. It is often waiting and going slow, but it's got an active nature to it. Patience is to still see that this thing is not good and still want to stand against it, but it's to wait for God to work. So I want to point out to you now briefly two resources there are for patience when the moment calls for it. And the first is in James chapter 5. It's going to tell us why we can be patient. Because I know in the heat of the moment or in the cold of the long season that calls for patience, it just feels impossible sometimes. It can feel like death to say no to what you want to, what you know you've got to say no to. But here in James chapter 5, we're given power. James chapter 5 says this, "Be patient then, brothers and sisters, until the Lord's coming. See how the farmer waits for the land to yield its valuable crop, patiently waiting for the autumn and spring rains. You too, in the same way, be patient and stand firm." See how it's not being smashed by your suffering. It's standing firm. Be patient and stand firm because the Lord's coming is near. James says the power for that patience comes from is knowing that the Lord is near. As Christians, we believe Jesus when he says in Matthew chapter 24 that he is coming again in power. It's hard to believe, and it's an intense idea, isn't it? Oh, sounds intense, the Jesus, second coming of Jesus. But it's what Jesus says, and we're Christians, and we believe Jesus. He's going to come in power. And what is he going to do? He's going to set the world straight. He's going to take darkness and evil out of our world and out of our hearts, and he's going to exterminate death so there won't be death anymore. This is the Christian hope. And this is why we can be patient. Because impatience and smashing or being smashed by our suffering is about feeling like you have to take things into your own hands and you have to set things straight. But we follow Jesus and we know that he will set things straight and that all things are seen by him and he will make things right. They will be good and there'll be order and there'll be balance when Jesus comes. And so we're able to wait on his action. We're able to go slowly. We're able to look forward to when we look at what's happening in front of us and say, this is not right. Where is God? I'm going to wait for him because he said he's going to work. He said he's going to do something. So we're patient. But there's a second resource for patience, and that is the Lord's patience. Because God too is patient. So often, maybe perhaps the biggest reason for doubt or the thing that causes most people doubt about God is the presence of suffering in our world. And I feel the weight, and I hope you feel the weight, because if you don't, you haven't really noticed how the world is. You notice the argument? The argument is, if the world is like this, and if this is happening to that person, if this is happening to me, how can God be good? Where is he? What's he doing? Because this is godless what is happening here. It's a strong argument. But the Bible says it's not because God's absent, it's not because he's not good, it's because he's patient. God sees it, but 2 Peter chapter 3 says, "The Lord is not slow as in keeping his promise, as some understand slowness, but he's patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance." The Bible says, yes, there's a lot of suffering, and God is not going to be slow to keep his promise to do right and to do good. But he's waiting for people to turn to him. You see, if God acted now, if I wanted to send my text now, and like I wanted to yell at someone on the beach yesterday, now, but if God acted now, like I want to act now, then it'd be terrible. It'd be terrible. Because there's not just darkness out there, there's darkness and selfishness. There's a flesh in here at work. There's 7 billion people who are trying to gratify the cravings of their own desires, and it's hurting people. And we'd be wiped out if God acted now. But God is patient, and he's waiting on you and I to turn to him and to come to him, that we not be wiped out. And he's waiting on Bondi to turn to him. God's patient. And I want you to see that God is at his most patient, or his patience is most clearly seen at the cross of Jesus. You see, the Son of God, who is patient, and he's got all the fruit of the Spirit, actually, Jesus. Love and joy, peace, patience and kindness and gentleness and goodness and self-control. The one who is fruitful in these things, is hung up on a cross, and his flesh is pierced. And he says that it's for us, that it's for the impatience of the world, and that the selfish fleshly desires of the world is being crucified in him, because he's patient and forgiving with us. Jesus is patient with us. And he was so patient that, do you remember, I think it's the night before he dies, he says, if I wanted 10,000 angels to come and set me free right now, I could. I could act in the immediate. I could play the short game. But that's not what I'm doing. I'm playing the long game. I want you to notice that Jesus is patient, and he's put up on a cross. Any of those single moments of pain, he could have ended the suffering of himself by calling down legions of angels. But he's slow and long-suffering because he loves us. And he's waiting for us to turn and take him up on his offer of free forgiveness. Final thing I want to say is, what I've said is God wants to grow patience in us. Second thing I've said is there's 2 alternatives to patience. Third thing I've said is Abraham is both an example and a bad example of patience. And then I've shown you 2 areas of power for patience. Dialing into the fact that Jesus is coming. And noticing the patience of God, that he hasn't come yet, is his patience at work and seen in the cross. And the final thing I want to say is, how do we stand firm in patience rather than just be owned by our suffering? I think the answer is by prayer. Prayer is the thing that you do when you're being patient, because you don't just not do anything. You don't play the immediate game, but you do play the long game. And the thing that you do in that moment is prayer. It's amazing to me. It's a testimony to me of God that, as I say, it was impossible. It felt impossible. It felt like death for me not to send the text. And then when I prayed, God opened things up. It was an active moment. I prayed and asked him. And if you look at the Psalms, it's just full of David and the other Psalms asking God and demanding of God, you promised, and it doesn't look like it, and it can't even be true. Look, God, why won't you act? And prayer is the thing you do in the moment that calls for patience. It's not about just sitting down and being knocked over by our suffering. It's about standing against our suffering in prayer. It's the action that you do. Okay, I am going to pray very briefly. Nat's going to put a song on for us. It's time to reflect. And the song is a creed. It's a very ancient creed of the Christian church. And actually, Katrina's going to be responding to the creed soon. But we're going to have some time to listen to the creed and reflect on what we've heard. But let me pray first. Gracious God, thank you for your word, which is so powerful and beautiful and sweet to us. And I pray that you would help us to see the Spirit walking and where he's stepping, and we keep in step with him, and we be in conflict with our flesh and swim against it and keep in step with the Spirit, and you would grow beautiful things in us and around us. And we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Thank you. please join me now as we pray. Dear Lord, thank you that you're an amazing God. We thank you that we can trust in you because you know what's best for us. And we thank you that every good gift we have comes from you. Lord, one thing we ask, that we may dwell in your house all the days of our lives to gaze on your beauty. We pray that you would help us through the power of the Holy Spirit to live a holy life and to develop the characteristics of humility, love, tolerance, discipline, peace, faithfulness, and patience. Help us to be patient and to stand firm in our faith. And help us to live at peace with each other. And Lord, we just want to lift up to you the continuing COVID situation across the world. Lord, we pray for patience and endurance. We pray for wisdom for our governments. And we pray, Lord, for all those, especially in developing countries, who have less medical facilities than we do, Lord. We pray as vaccines start to roll out around the world that developing countries won't miss out on that. And we pray that the vaccines would go out smoothly and that we continue to pray, Lord, for those who are lonely and vulnerable, that you would be close to them, Lord. And we pray, Lord, that throughout this crisis, Lord, that many hearts will turn to you. And, Lord, we just want to thank you for Bondi. Thank you for summer and for this amazing weather. Lord, we pray that you would be working in people's hearts in this place, Lord, drawing them towards you. And we pray for open doors in Jesus' name for your gospel message. And Lord, we pray for the Christianity Explored course starting on Monday night. We just pray that this would be a really awesome time and that your hand will be on each person that comes along to that, Lord, and that they would grow in their knowledge and understanding of what it means to be a Christian. And that many would put their faith in you as a result of that course. Lord, we pray for youth group, and we thank you for all the leaders that give their time each week to youth group. And thank you for all the kids that come along. And we just continue to pray that youth group each Friday night will be a really fun time for everyone that comes along. And most of all, Lord, that they would encounter you and learn more about you, and just grow in their friendships with each other. And we also pray and thank you for our Pop and Bop ministry to toddlers and parents and carers. Thank you so much for how popular that is and for everyone that comes along to it each week, for all the volunteers and for all the hard work that Belinda puts into that. Lord, we just pray that you would bless that ministry, Lord, and that many, many people would come to know you through Hop and Bop, Lord. And we just pray for energy and for wisdom for Belinda and all the leaders. Lord, we thank you so much that Katrina is being baptized tonight. Lord, we pray that you'd fill her with your peace and assurance by the power of the Holy Spirit. Lord, we pray that you would be so close to her, growing her in her knowledge and love of you, and that you would bless her and Attila as they bring up little James in your care. Lord, we pray that the baptism tonight down at the beach would be a really lovely time full of joy and celebration, and that it would be a witness to those around about down at the beach. And we pray all these things in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.
We're going to meet Katrina in a bit, and Blake's going to interact, ask a few questions, then we're going to go down the beach. It'll be fun and have baptism. But what is baptism? Well, let me just try and explain it very quickly. Baptism is like ceremonial washing. Katrina is a very clean person. We don't need to wash her. She's already clean. But she's going to get ceremonial cleansed because it's a symbol of what's happened to her spiritually. It's like an external sign of what's happened to her internally. It's like it's a physical sign of what's happened to her spiritually as she's come to Jesus and trusted him for forgiveness. That's what happens when anyone's get baptized. Doesn't matter if they're babies, older, younger, when there's this much water or that much water. But the word baptism comes from the Greek word baptizo. It means to submerge. And if you're going along and you want to speak Greek to someone and a ship sinks, you say, oh, that ship just got baptizo. Every time you go into the bath, you're baptizing yourself if you put your head under. And so Katrina's going to go down. Blake is going to ask some questions. They're going to interact up here. And then she's going to be baptized. Why? Because Jesus said that's what happens. After Jesus died and rose again, and before he went to heaven, he said this: go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I've commanded, and surely I'm with you always, even to the very end of the age. And then in the New Testament, we have descriptions of the early Christians when they first trust Jesus being baptized. As the thousands of years went along and Christian families wanted to introduce their children into Christ, they baptized their children. So we baptize children here too. We're not ashamed of that. That's fine. We're baptizing them and praying that they'll grow up to follow and obey Jesus. And when people, adults or older people, become Christians, we baptize them too. And it's a great thing to do at the beach because they did it publicly. There's lots of accounts in the New Testament of this happening. But I think I just want to say one verse, and that is this. Baptism is an external sign of a clean conscience before God. I'll just read the passage. It says, it's not the external water which saves you. This water symbolizes baptism that saves you. Not the removal of dirt from the body, but the pledge of a good conscience towards God. That's a passage from 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 21. And that is, Katrina has a good conscience before God because she knows that her sins and everything which spiritually was separated from God has been dealt with in Jesus. And all of us who are Christians could draw encouragement when we see the baptism just in a few moments. So I'll leave to Blake now to come up and talk to Katrina, and then we'll go to the beach for baptism. And Blake will explain more of how that's going to work. Is that right, Blake? Cool. Good to see you, Katrina. Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Kids, can you see what Katrina is wearing? I've got board shorts on. What's Katrina got on? It's a wedding dress. And now this is unscripted. When did you wear this dress to get married, and where were you? Where did you guys get married?
In Karimba.
Karimba, nice. And what year was that?
Oh,
2018. 2018, cool. Well, nice to get a second workout, and we'll talk about that. I've got a few questions that I just want people to hear what you have to say, and we'll talk about the dress too. And James is very welcome to interrupt as much as he likes. So just one question, Katrina, why are you a Christian?
I'm a Christian because I share the same values that Christianity does. And also I believe in higher power that guides us. Also I believe in love and kindness, forgiveness and second chances.
Yep. And do you want me to tell the story about the dress, or do you want to tell the story about the dress? So the way the dress thing happened is that they brought James to be to have a Thanksgiving or a baptism with us, and so I caught up with Attila and Katrina. And I mean, beautifully, honestly, Katrina said, look, in Latvia, when you get baptized, the priest says you have to come to church for like 6, 7, 8, 9 weeks in a row. And she said, I don't like that because it feels like you have to pay for baptism. And I said, well, I went like this in myself because I was about to say, you need to come to church 6 or 7 times. I said to them, okay, I'm going to tell you, yes, you have to come to church 6, 7, 8, 9 times, but not because you have to pay for baptism, but because baptism is about getting married to Jesus. And to get married to Jesus is, or like to get married to anybody, you know, it's a bit of a commitment. It's a real commitment. It's a lifelong commitment. And I just want you to make sure that you know what he's about and what he's like and who he is. And then so you graciously said, all right, fine, we'll come to church for a bit. And then after maybe 6 or 7 weeks, Katrina came up to me and said, you know, let's keep going ahead with the James thing. But she said, I want to get baptized myself because I want to get married to Jesus. And I want to do it at the beach with a wedding dress on. So I think that's such a special thing that Katrina has seen, that the Christian faith is about being united to Jesus and having him, and everything that his is yours now. And everything that's yours is his now. And so I thought that was a lovely idea. I said, you really want, just the pandemic happened, and so we paused. And then when it was time to start opening up again, I said, you still want to get baptized? She said, yes. I said, you still want to do the wedding dress thing, like about getting married to Jesus, being united to him? And she said, yep. So that's the story there. And I think it's going to be great. And Katrina, I also just want to ask, is there a part of the Bible that particularly resounds with you and that you appreciate at the moment? And can you share that with us?
Yes, here's a pronouncement for me.
Sure. John, can you read it? How much? That
season?
Yeah. Yeah, okay, I'll read it. Okay. So it's from Ecclesiastes, the bit that Katrina wanted to point out. And this is it. Again, honest. I love Katrina's honesty. Meaningless, meaningless, says the teacher. Utterly meaningless. Everything is meaningless. What do people gain from all their labor in which they toil under the sun? Generations come and generations go, but the earth remains forever. The sun rises and the sun sets and hurries back to where it rises. The wind blows to the south and turns to the north and goes round and round it goes, ever returning on its course. All streams flow into the sea, yet the sea is never full. To the place the stream comes from, there they return again. All things are wearisome, more than one can say. What do you like about that? There's a few people like, yes. But yeah, what is it that you appreciate about that?
I really like it because, to sum it up kind of, it says don't sweat the small things, because sun will come up and set regardless what's happening. So if you're having a bad day, it will come and it will go. So at the moment, James is teething. So for me, it's a good reminder. Also
will
pass.
Yeah.
So yes.
Yeah. Great. Good. Thank you for sharing. I want to take you through some questions that I've already showed Katrina that you want.
Yes.
I want to take you through some questions that really show us what's going on inside of Katrina. So Katrina, I want to ask you, and we talked about the flesh tonight actually come up here. Do you renounce the devil and all his works, the empty displays and false values of the world and the sinful desires of the flesh, so that you'll not follow or be led by them?
I renounce them all.
And this one's a bit of a long one, like from the song. Katrina, do you believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth? And do you believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, that he was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried, that he went down to the place of the dead, that he rose on the third day, and he ascended into heaven, and he seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty, and from there shall come to judge the living and the dead? And do you believe in the Holy Spirit, the holy universal church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting? And Katrina, will you follow Jesus faithfully and obey his commands throughout your life?
With God's help, I intend to do
so. Finally, do you ask for baptism in this faith that you've professed?
I do.
Great. Well, what we're going to do now is walk down to the beach together, and then I'm going to, you might not be able to hear, you might be able to, we'll see what the surf conditions are like and how hearing goes. I'm going to baptize Katrina by bringing her under the water as a picture of both washing and death, and then bring her back out of the water as a picture of being washed and coming to a new life, new Katrina. And I'm going to baptize her in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And then I'm going to sign you with the cross to show that you're to fight bravely for Christ. So the way that we'll do that is, there's a few steps. We're going to take 2 minutes to quickly use the loo if I need to. And then we're all going to meet out on the path just here, socially distanced, until the doors are locked. And then we'll walk down together, socially distanced. And then I'm going to pick a spot, a safe spot, and I'll confer with the other lifesavers in the congregation. I will pick a good spot for baptizing that's deep enough but not too deep to get pulled out and ripped. There is just in the last few years, there was a pastor that was baptizing someone in, I think, Lake Malawi or something over in Africa. He got eaten by a crocodile while he was baptizing. So let's hope that we do better tonight. There's a picture of death. Anyway, so we're picking a good spot. But what I want you to do, congregation, is you're there to kind of support and witness. And this is really, I'm so glad you're doing this, both doing it and in your dress. It's going to be good for the kids to see a picture. It's good for all of us, actually. And what I want you to do is, when we find a spot, I want you to come to the spot together, right down to the water, sort of social distance, and be a crowd. But don't kind of stand up on the promenade. I want you to come down, unless you've got personal reasons, which you might. But I want you to come down to the water's edge with us, please. Okay, and then after that, we'll clap, and then our formal time together will be over, and you can kind of hang around, you can go for a swim. I'm going to stay in the water and congratulate the trainer, or you can start moving home, whatever you like. But basically, the formal part of stuff is finished after the baptism. Cool? And there's cookies. The trainer brought cookies back there, all wrapped up. So you can grab one of them if you like. Thank you. That's very kind. Okay, I'm going to pray really briefly now, and then you've got 2 minutes to meet out the front. Gracious God, we thank you for Katrina. This is a great moment, and we ask you to show us the picture of what you're doing and what you've done inside. And we pray it'd be really special for her and for us. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
All right, let's head out and meet at the front. Thank you.